Please stand by. We're about to begin. Good day and welcome to today's webinar. At this time, I would like to turn the conference over to your host, Ms. Genevieve Erb. Please go ahead, ma'am.
Thank you, Jessica. Hi, everyone. I'm Genevieve Erb from Capgemini. Thank you so much for joining us today for our webinar titled Maps, Facts, and Stats, Oh My, Exploring Spatial Analytics and OBIEE 11G. Today, your presenters will be Christian Screen from Capgemini and Steve Lytle from Nokia. Christian, first, a little bit about our speakers today. Christian is a recipient of an Oracle ACE Award and is a leader in Capgemini's Oracle Analytics practice, formerly known as BI Consulting Group. Christian is a business intelligence evangelist with over 15 years of experience in technologies ranging from low-level programming, e-commerce, data warehousing, EPM, and, of course, business intelligence. Steve has been involved in the maps and location content software industry for over 30 years. Currently with the Enterprise Americas team for Nokia's Location and Commerce Business Unit, he manages its Oracle's activity since 2005 and has been leading the efforts to integrate and commercialize NAVTEQ Maps for OBIEE since 2007. A little bit of information regarding the flow of today's events. Christian and Steve will take us through our presentation. We'll have time at the end for a brief Q&A as well. If you would, please submit your questions throughout today's session using the Q&A WebEx panel, and we'll review prior to closing the call. And please note, we are recording today's session. We'll be sending an email follow-up shortly with a link to the presentation as well as the recording. With that, without further ado, please let's begin our presentation. I'll hand it over to Christian.
Hi, and thanks, Genevieve, for that wonderful introduction. This is Christian Screen from Capgemini and the Oracle Analytics Practice. And we have a very exciting webinar for everyone today, talking about spatial analytics, working with Oracle Spatial and Oracle Business Intelligence 11G. And as far as an agenda today, we're going to keep it fairly straightforward. We have a couple things that we want to tackle right up front, which is defining spatial analytics. We're going to look at Oracle BI 11G, Oracle Spatial, and NAVTEQ. We're also going to talk about how you can get started with localization intelligence and spatial analytics within your organization. We're also going to look at NAVTEQ. We have Steve Lytle here from NAVTEQ, who's going to give you a great overview about NAVTEQ and how that integrates with OBIEE. And then we're going to ask ourselves a question, how does spatial analytics make you smarter? And we're going to tie it all together, and we're going to talk about what components you actually need for localization intelligence and spatial analytics. And then, as Genevieve mentioned, we're going to wrap it up with some Q&A. So let's think briefly about spatial analytics. And we know about analytics in an organization. Most of you who are attending this webinar most likely have Oracle Business Intelligence in-house. And we know what questions analytics can answer for us, but when we add geography and spatial representations on top of those analytics, it enables us to answer questions like where, how close, how far, what's this next to, and plus all the other answers to known questions, which is basically what standard analytics is. And then on top of having that geographic information in line with our analytics, we can, of course, topple on existing trending KPIs and more coming from our standard analytics that we have in our organization already. So the organization's structuring and perspective analysis of area-specific metadata combined with pre-existing data metrics or KPIs is really what spatial analytics is. And if we break that down to almost an industry definition of spatial analysis, there have been some very brilliant people out there who have kind of put this definition together. And they're trying to say spatial analysis is the analytical techniques, or is the analytical techniques to determine the spatial distribution of a variable, the relationship between the spatial distribution of variables, and the association of variables in an area. That's a tongue twister, but that's more of the technical definition of just general spatial analysis. And what we're looking for is spatial analytics. And what does that actually mean? And so the majority of us out there who use a tool like Oracle Business Intelligence, we think of a geographic map as the basis construct, if you will, of spatial analytics. But we want you to think a little bit differently as well, because spatial analytics also involves anything having to do with something where you can represent the space of something, not just the necessary geography. So if you think about a CAD drawing, you might have a CAD drawing of, let's say, an office building layout, conference rooms in an office building, so forth and so on. And then if we go back to our geographic map representation, we can think about layering that map, okay? We might look at streets, or we might look at satellite imaging, railways, et cetera. So spatial analytics encompasses a lot, especially as we're looking at it visually. And we often get asked the question of, well, what's a good use case? Like, why or how can I implement spatial analytics in our organization? You know, what's going to be a good business case? How can I present this to the business or get approval to embark on a spatial analytics endeavor? And so we've been working with a lot of clients here at Capgemini, and here are just some of the use cases that we like to throw out. Perhaps you're looking at the distance between an office or warehouse from your customers. Okay, that's going to help you to determine the quickest path to satisfying and supplying your customers. If you're an insurance organization, think about it this way. If you're able to look at risk associated with certain portfolios based on a geographic area where you've been able to compile data where a specific area might have been more attuned to catastrophes to another, that might provide some sort of variable for your calculation on how you calculate risk. All right? General technical plotting, perhaps you just need a map for your operations where you're plotting where your retail shops are, where dealer locations are. I mentioned the example of conference room bookings. So again, perhaps we're a building management company or we're a corporation, and we want to track the most populated conference rooms on a certain floor. So we know if we need to take an office adjacent to a very busy conference room and turn that into a conference room so that we're fulfilling the need of the meetings that are taking place. We have a customer who is using spatial analytics for cell phone tower allocations. And so there's a lot of great use cases here where spatial analytics can really bring new definition and answer new questions for your organization. Also in basketball. So, again, a representation of any spatial area can be used for spatial analytics. Here we're just looking at, say, a comparison of Al Jefferson, who I think plays for Utah Jazz, and Ray Allen, who plays for the Boston Celtics. And this is basically a compilation of data points for field goal attempts. And so as we can see here, the plot of points within this spatial area gives us a very good indication of a certain metric. And so, like I mentioned before, one of the things that we want our customers and organizations to do is get started with spatial analytics. This is going to be a big win, especially as mobile business intelligence comes into play. So how can your organization get started with spatial analytics? Well, we think the first step that you need to do is grab a use case, okay? And we think from the list of use cases that we provided, or perhaps you have a use case internally, go ahead and take that use case and start building off of that. Most organizations already have spatial or geocoding data internally. Now, that could be from a one-time data feed license that you've already had in-house. Perhaps you're a large corporation or retail organization and you have a real estate department or something like this. So perhaps you have a data set of spatial already in-house. Or perhaps you're using a geocoding service. So you're doing some SaaS, you're using a SaaS service right now. And that brings me to our polling question for today's webinar. And you should see a poll pop up on your screen here. And the poll is asking, is your organization currently using geospatial map data? Perhaps you know, perhaps you're not, but if you could fill that in. and let us know. And so regardless if you're using a static data set or a service-based data set, the fact is you might have that internally. And one of the things that we're seeing with our customers is as we embark on a spatial analytics project, one of the things that we see is that we're bringing within the analytics space, we're bringing these components together because perhaps only the real estate department of an organization is using that spatial service. But perhaps there's a need within another department who actually needs that that spatial data. Perhaps it's the sales or marketing department. Okay? So what we're seeing as we embark on these projects is basically reaching out to these other departments internally and bringing that back in to fulfill the project needs. Okay? And we have one more poll that's kind of a follow-up to the first poll question, and that is, if you answered yes to the first poll question, what software platform does your organization currently use? Is it an Oracle platform, perhaps, ESRI, or perhaps another platform or service that you're using right now? Okay. So as you're answering that question, let me just continue on with some tips that we have for getting your organization started. Another item is you want to get a sponsor. So this is typical in most analytics or business intelligence endeavors with an organization. You get a sponsor that's going to really help drive the effort. Perhaps you are that sponsor in your organization, and you're just looking for that quick win. And what we're seeing is getting a proof of concept going based on one of those use cases is the direct path to getting a quick win with Oracle Spatial. All right? Also, we often get the question about licensing, okay? And as far as software is concerned, we'd like to let our clients know that MapViewer is part of Oracle BI 11G. So if you have the Oracle BI or OBIEE 11G software solution, MapViewer comes as part of that, and it's actually very well integrated into that system. And lastly, if you're looking for examples on spatial analytics, examples are everywhere on the web. It's a quick web search away. And I've got a quick link here that provides an actual public-facing example of how OBIEE is integrating with spatial analytics for a government agency. And so that's the New York City government. You can access that by nyc.gov /CPR. Okay. And what I want to do right now is turn the presentation over to Steve Lytle from NAVTEQ, and he's going to talk to you a little bit about how NAVTEQ is going to can work with your organization and OBIEE together. So, Steve?
Well, thanks, Christian, and thanks, everybody, for attending today. Certainly appreciate that. And then, Christian, if you could just hand me the ball for the presentation, that's great. Part of what I wanted to do today is to, in conjunction and integration with what Christian has set up, is really kind of do a deep dive into what we can bring together in terms of the NAVTEQ map content and through what the organization of the Nokia Location of Commerce that I participate in. I thought we'd just touch a little bit about the map-based analytics, something that Christian has already been speaking about, and then go through how that gets bundled with OBIEE. Spend a few minutes on the Nokia Location of Commerce group and the Oracle ecosystem that we have been building and participating in. And lastly, kind of wrap it up with just a high-level overview of our company to give you a sense of what we've been doing and where we've been going and things like that. So briefly on the map-based analytics, you've already seen some slides. If your organization is already currently using mapping map content, which I saw from the poll, this is just another example of your classic dashboard, looking at thematic maps, looking at the business data that's spread across that, and also involving that with some graphics on that. So when you see the tabular data, which you've been used to seeing for so many years, it takes a different look and feel, and that's when it gets to a map, and that's how we start to kick this thing off. Another way to look at that is a little more different ways in the same data, maybe looking at it from both a mapping context, but different ways to look at it, whether it's graphing-based and whether it's looking at circle base, the size of the circle represents the magnitude of the data or the metric itself, and the colorization. Again, a lot of this is, comes from that same data set that you've been looking at or been building, but starting to look at the interrelationships of this. And this is kind of a classic view that you can be achieving through deployments through OBIEE and the NAVTEQ maps. Excuse me. Missed that one. More from an architectural structural point of view, you do have the table data. It does link to some geometry, whether that be a boundary or whether that be a point, and then the values of that can be colorized. It can be done in terms of sizing of particular data elements. So that's kind of the actual architectural connection between the data that's in the table and how that represents back onto the geometry or the geometric feature that you have on the maps. I've been seeing a lot of deployments, questions about service territory, so sales and service territory. So a lot of the customers that I've been working with have been putting their data out in terms of, are my sales territories correct for the business that I have? Are they underperforming? Are they overperforming? And doing maybe some realignment of sales territory. So my particular experience, I've been seeing a lot of the interest in that particular type of use of this data. Okay, I want to quickly move over to then the specifics on the NAVTEQ maps for OBIEE and spend a few minutes on that. And again, I know we're going to take Q&A at the end of the session today, so please don't hesitate to put your questions in that we will collect and that we can answer it at the end. I do get a lot of questions from customers on this. So the key thing here is the NAVTEQ maps include detailed streets, core POIs or points of interest, and administrative boundaries. So people will say, well, what do you really have and what are we really beginning? The streets database themselves contain the latitude, longitude, or the coordinates and address location coding on each individual street segment. There are many, many, many other variables on the NAVTEQ map content that are on those streets or in that particular database. But when you get down into the BI side or the analytics side, we really look at just a subset of that. We also have another data suite or data set for what we call premium boundary data sets. Examples of that are like postal codes, census, and neighborhoods or neighborhood boundaries, which is a new feature set that we've been we brought to market. It's been has a lot of interest is being used on that. And then thirdly, another premium data set that we have is what we call point data sets, and those include point and micro point addresses, postal points, and extended POIs. And now just briefly, I'll just touch a little bit on the point and micro point addresses that have been used a lot for as you location enable your data sets or geocode. It improves the quality of that and gets used more and more and more, particularly with respect to geocoding. And even postal points, so where you may have a reduced quality need, postal points is another way of doing it versus addressing. So postal points are used quite a bit in the geocoding process as well. Okay, and then now as we at NAVTEQ, or really the Nokia group, had enabled or licensed Oracle to bundle our data sets with OBIEE. The intent was to get people familiar, get customers familiar and users familiar with data sets, with geographic data sets on global basis and also on a local basis. My graphic on the upper left where I have the bundled arrow to, that's the kind of thing that you have been seeing if you opened up OBIEE, which comes with the product itself. Down in the lower right corner is really our detailed data set that we have available, and that's really on a license fee basis. So some people, I've seen some misconceptions where they say, oh, we get all this data that comes with it. Yes, you do, and there is a lot of data, and that's in the bundle, but when you get down to the detail, then that comes back to us for licensing purposes. On the postal code, census, and neighborhood boundary types, this is an example of an area in Mexico for census data. Census is being used a lot for different demographic data sets on the tabular side. And the postal code, census, and neighborhoods, again, are throughout the deployments in North America and also and globally, to give you a sense for that. So you'll see on any kind of boundary set, which I think you're familiar with, I'll restate it, is really for a lot of thematic mapping also posting the tabular data across geographic boundaries. Speaking briefly then to the point and micropoint addressing, and this is really as it relates to geocoding or location enabling a data set. And so what we really get with the point addressing are discrete points related to a particular piece of property. So when you have geocoding that just gets assigned against or extracted against a street segment, it could be anywhere along that street based on the two endpoints. But when you get into point and micropoint addressing, then it is an actual discrete point on the real world that represents that particular property. The micropoint addressing is specific then to either a multi-dwelling type of unit or a business office suite type of example. So you may have an apartment at that has multiple apartment 26 and an apartment 35, but you still have only one unique address point on this, so this is helpful in handling those kinds of situations. And just to get down to some of the pragmatic aspects of licensing the NAVTEQ map content, which I do get questions on, and I thought this would be a good time to then just kind of provide that information to you. We do license it based on the number of users, examples being 100, 500, 1,000, whatever your particular organization or your particular deployment may envision. We do ask the questions in terms of geographic coverage. Your particular deployment could be for the U.S. or U.S. and Canada only, or maybe it's global, maybe it's for Europe or APAC. The NAVTEQ content is available across the world for all different kinds of configurations of geographic coverage. So you want to think in terms of number of users. You want to think in terms of geographic coverage, and you can always begin for a smaller area and then build out and deploy as a further rollout time phase. That's perfectly acceptable. We do see a lot of that. Our pricing is annual, where the term, even though the term of the OBIE use case license can be more than the 1 year, and I typically write ones for 3 years. So I just wanted to touch bases on that, is that pricing is always annual, but you may have a three-year license agreement with us for the NAVTEQ content, just to give you a feel for that. Here's an example of pricing. Some people say, oh, you don't want to discuss pricing in webinars. I think it's always a good idea to give people a sense and a data point on this. So for the 100-user count for U.S. coverage for the core data sets is $23,900 per year. And then that can grow and scale against your particular uses, and we have volume tiering and things like that. So this kind of gives you just an example, gives you a data point on what's behind all this in terms of how do I price it, what are the use cases, what are the parameters for licensing. And the Nokia LNC group, which is where I am, and its authorized channel license and NAVTEQ maps for OBIEE, don't hesitate to send me an email, call me, go back to Christian if you have any further questions on this for the licensing aspects. Having said that, I want to talk about, spend a few moments on the group, the Nokia LNC group, and the Oracle ecosystem. This is something that I've been deeply involved in for the last certainly 7 years. I've been working at the organization, but even further back, Nokia and Oracle have been collaborating since 2002. So we have over a 10-year relationship, so we have built a lot of relationships between the two companies. A lot of technology has passed back through the company, so you're in good hands. It's not something that we just had an idea last year or something like that. That is not the case in this sense. We shipped our first Oracle-ready maps in 2002, and which has grown dramatically, as you can imagine. And this is a good point that you should know, that Oracle, as an organization, has a global license agreement with us for all of our content, and which they can eat for evaluation, for development purposes, and for demonstration purposes. And as you can imagine, Oracle being who they are, their 84,000 employees, their acquisitions that they're making all the times, we see a lot of new groups and dip into the NAVTEQ content database that they have and begin to build applications and extend their technology reach for location and for map content. We'll speak about that in just a moment here. But having said that, we are the only turnkey provider of global content for mapping, geocoding, and routing services for the Oracle stack or the ecosystem. We've been doing it for a number of years, so you can imagine. But it's also that we not only do it on a one-time basis, it's always a highly maintained commercial database that we continually to bring to market, maintain it, and bring new content available, and work closely with Oracle in terms of how they can use that content. A takeaway point here, which is good, is that Oracle does not relicense the NAVTEQ maps. That's a corporate it's a corporate policy that they have for any third-party certainly content and technologies. And even though that for you as an end user, you want to keep that in mind, it certainly could be useful if they did that, but they don't. And so that's why we want to extend ourselves for licensing purposes or questions to go back through us as an organization, go back through Christian and the Capgemini organization, or any of the other channeled third-party channels that you may see. So that's just something to keep in mind here. We use this graphic a lot in terms of how do you communicate, the NAVTEQ map content and, again, the Oracle database and the various applications or technologies off of that. It kind of gives people a sense of how is this thing put together. Where we are a database, we are a geographic database, we are deployed inside the Oracle database and through the Oracle Spatial option itself. So we kind of sit in the middle of this stuff. And then the different applications or technologies, in this particular case, the BI platform, then accesses or interrelates with that core database of both the NAVTEQ content that sits inside the Oracle Spatial. I work a lot with the different product groups, such as communications or such as utilities. Each one of those have their own separate applications that go back into the same exact database for different use cases and deployed. I see a lot of, if you kind of think of all this as really two areas, is business analytics and mobile. I do a lot of work with the mobile use cases of the NAVTEQ content through the Oracle ecosystem, through the Oracle platform. This particular session today is really speaking to the business analytics of that. So I deal with each one of these groups. We license against that. They're all different use cases, and they all have different applications associated with that. So I hope you hope this graphic is helpful to you and how you think of these things. It's been helpful for a lot of the organizations that I've been speaking to over the years. And think of this ecosystem and really what it is and its opportunity that it provides to everybody. You have the Oracle, you have the Oracle environment. That is the engine. That is the software. Those are the applications. And we are the content. So we think of ourselves as the fuel. So if you have the engine and you have the fuel, as you interact and put those things together, then off you're rolling in terms of your and your business and how you can improve your business decisions through time and all that. So think of us as the fuel, and Oracle is the engine itself. And I included this slide. I don't know. I hope it's useful for people that are attending today to kind of give you an architecture sense. So you have the database, which is obviously in the bottom tier in here, and then it holds out. It depicts the Oracle Spatial. It has the NAVTEQ delivery format. That's the ODF. That's the actual data that we deliver that gets downloaded into this the database itself. That's where your routing, your analytics, and your geocoding and the things like that really happen inside the database. Which then gets served up through the middle tier, the map viewer in this particular case, for the visualization, the APIs that then access through that particular middle tier to the database itself. But then what you're seeing as a more refined application of such as OBIE still goes through the same structure as in terms of the OBIE client, the dashboards, the business rules that you apply to that really goes through the middle tier and then down to the database itself. So this kind of gives you an architecture of how to think about in terms of where's the content, where does it sit within the Oracle stack, and then does that get affected through the middle tier and then out to the clients itself. And you can have multiple clients, whether it's a BI client or whether it's a mobile client or a GIS client or things in this particular same architecture or structure. Okay, and having said all that, so we talked a little bit about the map-based analytics and what it will bring to your organization. What is the really NAVTEQ content itself, and how does that then get accessed by the user community? A little bit about the ecosystem. And I thought I'd just spend just a few moments here on the Nokia Location and Commerce organization itself. And you've heard from Christian and myself talk about the NAVTEQ map content. That's really the branding that we had. Nokia did acquire NAVTEQ back in 2008. So that's a point there. That was their largest acquisition at that time and still remains the largest acquisition. So there was a very strategic acquisition that they did make. Earlier this year, it was formalized to create the Nokia Location and Commerce Organization. So we are a division within Nokia. The NAVTEQ map is the brand, and all of us are still intact in the way that we're moving forward. So I just want to make a note of that because you'll see, oh, am I dealing with NAVTEQ or I'm dealing with Nokia? You're really dealing with Nokia. The NAVTEQ maps is the branded content. So hopefully that was helpful to describe to you today. Our mission is content, content, content. We build maps. We collect data. We make that available, deployable, that's behind the firewalls in the applications such as OBIE, and we also provide the services through a platform which is more your traditional web service platform. I only touch on that briefly today, and then there's the apps that are associated with that. But think of us, we have a single purpose mission, which is content, content, content. Okay, this next series of builds off of this is, I mentioned the content that comes from the points, from the streets, from the different boundary sets, whether they be in this particular graphic, you can talk about whether it's transit data or fueling data or restaurant data, things like that. And then it gets accessed or made available through the platform for the positions or the maps or the places or the directions. And then across the multiple access points, really what you're thinking about here is off of the internet or your client, which is where your OBIE sits. As you might know, that because of who we are and what we do, we have a lot of devices that access our content, such as mobile devices, such as tablets, such as cars and navigations within that. But we're really speaking today about how you access it through the OBIE deployment scenario. And I just want to speak a bit a moment about how we invest in the database. It's not a one-time static database. We've been building that for over 25 years now. We invest over $300 million a year on that. We are a large organization. We have over 7,000 people globally that are in the business of collecting data, processing data, maintaining data, making that available to our global community. And, of course, it's a global data set. So that's what you kind of give you a sense of scale on this, of who we are, the kind of investment opportunities that we make in the database, and just also give you another sense, a data point is our annual sales as a group are over $1 billion a year. So just kind of give you a sense of scale on this sort of this business. This next slide is kind of interesting. If you look at your upper right and move down to your lower left, is really the upper right being in the, I want to say, early days that kind of dates us all back in 1985 when NAVTEQ organization began, is that there was a lot of collecting of data and processing data starting with map digitization. So for you and the audience have been using map data a long time, you know that maybe you started with, you know, doing map collection or database development really through the tablet-based digitization. That's all evolved into where we really are today, by doing everything that's collected by car, by high-technology devices that are on that car, high-technology sensors that are on that car, that are then collected at the point, at the drive point, and then sent back to the data processing centers. So it's really evolved in that. We're collecting 3D data right now. There's a lot of what we call point clouds that are collecting data all the time and then being processed and made commercially available for different use cases. This next slide just again is another kind of sense of a scale moving from the left, which is the different types and kinds of data and the quantities of that, such as 75 million places, 120 million point addresses, 500 plus point public transport cities across the world. There's a one graphic there about 45 NAVTEQ true cars. These true cars are these highly high-tech vehicles that are collecting data around the world. All the way to the right where you get a sense of access, the scales of accessing, whether you have 120 million map tiles that are being served up daily, over a billion search queries annually, things like that. So you have data and quantity metrics on the left and the type of access that's across the right, just to, give you another sense of what's going on here. And really with that, I think I'm turning it back over to Christian.
Hey, thanks, Steve. Yeah, and that was fantastic. And one of the reasons we wanted to have Steve from NAVTEQ and have this webinar in general was because we have so many clients who are Oracle Business Intelligence or Oracle Business Intelligence Applications clients who see now that you can get these wonderful visuals and maps from Map Viewer integrated into Oracle BI 11G, and we get a lot of questions on how can we do that? How do we get started? What actually comes out of the box with Oracle Business Intelligence in the way of mapping and spatial data? And then, of course, what do we have to buy? So I think what Steve has done as he went over his slides there is hopefully gave some insight into not only the foundation of NAVTEQ and some of their history and how much work they're putting in to provide this extreme amount of data, but also the integration points that come along from a high level to a very detailed level that we can leverage in Oracle Business Intelligence. So I understand I had audio problems at the beginning of the webinar, and hopefully those are sorted out. Hopefully everyone can hear me just fine now. And now what I want to do is just kind of talk about the combination between Oracle BI and Oracle Spatial. And again, like I mentioned a couple minutes ago, one of the questions for this webinar is really to answer a lot of the questions we get from our clients on getting started with spatial analytics. So one of the first points is, can we use our existing RPD and web catalog? Well, of course you can. So, and that's one of the most powerful things about OBIEE when we're getting clients up and running with spatial analytics. You can leverage your existing Oracle BI RPD. As a matter of fact, like we mentioned earlier, most organizations have a geography dimension within their subject areas within Oracle Business Intelligence. So we can even tap directly into those. And of course, with your existing web catalog, what extra do you have to do? We're going to talk about that in a minute. The Oracle database. So clearly, this webinar is about Oracle Spatial Analytics, and as Steve showed in one of his slides, the architecture of the middle layer with Map Viewer, the client consumption, and then of course the database where the NAVTEQ data immediately integrates. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about that, and then Map Viewer is a middle tier. We'll touch base on that, and Steve also talked about NAVTEQ. Right, we get that package data with OBI 11G, but then of course there's more detailed data depending on the requirements of maybe your POC or your project, and that's something that we've been working with NAVTEQ in order to help our clients with determining what level of granularity that they'll need. And then we're going to talk briefly about Map Viewer. So, like I mentioned, with your existing RPD and web catalog, yes, let's start there. Let's integrate that in with some of the NAVTEQ data and get up and running with Oracle Spatial Analytics. So with the initial RPD, with most of you are probably familiar, the repository for Oracle Business Intelligence, you can tie into your existing geography dimensions. You can even roll your custom geography and drilling if desired. One of the things that Steve talked about was NAVTEQ, which I believe is the only organization that is providing an OBIEE-specific data set. So not only are they providing data out of the box with Oracle BI 11G, but once you actually go into the process of purchasing the data, their team has actually worked really hard to provide some specific data elements and drill paths that are specific to OBIEE. Okay? And then, of course, you can, because we're using Oracle Spatial within the database, we can also directly hit the Oracle database and Oracle Spatial, leverage algorithms and geocoding methods, et cetera. Okay. Next, of course, again with Oracle RPD and Web Catalog, let's talk about the Web Catalog a little bit. So the Web Catalog in Oracle BI 11G, integrating maps is already built in. So as part of the administration process of the web catalog, we can go in and we can pick which data source, which layers, which backgrounds, and which images we want to integrate or have represented in our web catalog and any of our our views or any analysis requests that we create. We can attach those to specific subject areas. We can also set up default Zoom. So when a user opens up a report where there's the map viewer integration, it can zoom to a specific level and so forth and so on. So it's very dynamic. Okay. Steve also mentioned that Oracle and NAVTEQ have had a very long relationship. So again, just to talk a little bit about how in-depth Oracle is with the spatial side of things, they've been working on Oracle Spatial for more than a decade, almost two decades now. Oracle Database 11g offers one of the most powerful spatial offerings in a database system with one of the main data types of geometry data type, SDO geometry. And typically, there's no extra programming skills really to learn spatial when you're working with Oracle Spatial. If you you have a team that's familiar with just typical SQL, the learning curve is very small. Steve also mentioned Oracle Map Viewer, so let's put that in the context of Oracle Business Intelligence 11g. So I mentioned earlier that Map Viewer is part of the Oracle Business Intelligence Enterprise Edition suite. It's a Java-based web application, okay? And it's going to be that middle area between the presentation and the data. We talked about the architecture a little bit, but some of the really interesting and advanced things with that in that viewer is that you can customize this, okay? You can do a lot of interesting things with your data and with the spatial data that you can be getting from NAVTEQ. Okay. And then, of course, Steve did a great job covering exactly what NAVTEQ can provide, a little bit on the price point as well, and then some other items as far as some of the backbone of the GIS data and services they offer. So I won't go into that too much more, but just know that it's a very nice marriage between Oracle Business Intelligence, MapViewer, Oracle Spatial, and NAVTEQ, and it really does help an organization begin to understand their geographic data as it relates to their analytic data, and it really helps an organization get into what's becoming a very big buzzword these days, which is location intelligence, and that's going to become much bigger as we start adopting mobile business intelligence. You're going to see a lot more location intelligence built into that, and I do believe that the very next release of the Oracle Business Intelligence Mobile application for the iPad is going to incorporate location intelligence natively, so it'll be able to pick up the geography of someone who's holding that device, pull in that latitude and longitude of that user, and then internally within that app, you'll be able to reference that information. Okay, and the last piece is Map Builder. This is something you might have seen if you've been leveraging MapViewer internally at your organization already. And this is another Java-based application, but what it really does is it aids in the development of some of those custom pieces that you might want to incorporate into your spatial analytics projects. So, for example, we're working with clients right now who are looking at doing custom regions. So, for example, if they have region 8 within their organization, which is a combination of, let's say, California, Nevada, and Washington State. Well, that's a combination of three different states. And then what we can do using this tool is combine those into a custom region. And that's a little more advanced, but it's something that's definitely doable within this tool and the integration of Oracle Spatial Analytics. Okay. Well, I first, hopefully everyone has submitted some questions for the Q&A, and I definitely want to thank Steve Lytle for being on the webinar today. And if you have any questions, please submit them now. I'm going to turn it over to Jessica, who I think is also going to be taking some questions from the phone as well as from our Q&A queue. So, Jessica, let me turn it over to you.
Thank you. If you would like to ask a question, please signal by pressing the star 1 on your telephone keypad. If you are using a speakerphone, please make sure your mute function is turned off to allow your signal to reach our equipment. Please be aware that a voice prompt on your phone line will indicate when your line is open. At that point, please state your name before posing your question. Once again, please press star 1 to be placed into the queue. And we'll pause for just a moment.
Okay, Jessica, it looks like we've got a couple of questions coming through the queue over here, and I'll just kind of rattle those off, if you don't mind.
No problem.
All right, and Steve, I think this is a question for you. I think Caitlin has a question on, does the census info include age?
Yes, we have our for the main census boundary data sets that we do provide, we do have a small group of variables that are being offered with that, and age is one of those. And if you send me an email, I can send you the different variables that are. So it's kind of a basic data set of the demographics and the variables that are associated with the geometry itself, which you can get a lot more variables, as you well know, from others. But this is a base set that we are offering. So the answer is yes.
Okay. And Caitlin also has another question. So we've talked a lot about Oracle being the core database. The question is, if our data warehouse is SQL Server, will this function, will be to integrate the NAVTEQ data?
The key thing that we would have is asked to answer that question is there a database, does the SQL Server database then support the geometry, which is key for us? And I believe that there is a mechanism of the SQL Server database that does support the map content, but I don't know off the top of my head exactly how that would work, to tell you the truth. Like, we do know a lot about, of course, how Oracle does it, what others are doing it. But again, if you send me a follow-up email, I can check exactly how that does work, because I do know organizations are using the NAVTEQ content on the SQL Server.
Yeah, and I do believe the latest release of SQL Server does support spatial to some degree. All right, and Tom also has a question. So it's another question for you, Steve. You mentioned pricing for the core is, you know, X amount of dollars. You also mentioned for the core price included the core content versus what is included in the purchase of the OBI base. So I think they're just kind of looking for, you know, basically what's coming out of the box versus the core licensing that you mentioned earlier.
Okay, I'm not quite sure under the question. Is this the question from Tom that we're looking at right now?
Right. Yep, that's the one.
Okay. So for our core, what I call our core licensable database, which is the detailed street level data and the points of interest and the boundaries that are in that particular core and for the particular geography that I mentioned, which I think is the U.S., that is the $23,900 per year. And so that will vary then against how much geography that you want, or if you want additional premium content besides the core. When I do mention the core member, it's the street level, detailed street level data, and then the core POIs, and then the core boundaries that are with that. I hope, Tom, that answers your question on that, what's included. Again, we can provide you a very detailed response in terms of what all is included, but that's the, we think of it in terms of the core database. And that's for the usage with OBIE and its functionality.
Right, and I'll further that question, Thomas, as you can have a follow-up question there. So you're trying to just get an idea of what's free, right? And when I look at that, I say free as with OBIE 11G and included versus what is in the core license, right, with the yearly fee associated with it.
Okay,
right.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so all I was going to add to that, Steve, was so definitely what's coming out of the box for the sample information for NAVTEQ, that's going to be something, like Steve mentioned, it's going to have definitely some North American data, and it's going to be great for something like a proof of concept to kind of get you guys going.
Yeah, exactly. So it's really meant for that, for the organizations to get a feel for how they can use map content. What's inside that, which is bundled with it, a couple of layers of not street data, but regional highways. There are points that are in that do not have many variables associated with it. And for the U.S. in particular, the boundaries then go down to the county level. So when you get into it as a user, and you say, well, I need more detailed information, like for street, I need street-based data, I need the geocode addresses and things like that, you will need then to go over to the fee-based licensing content that we have. So you can think of what's bundled with it. You're going to get some basic highway road network. You're going to get some points of interest or points that do not have a lot of attribution associated with that. And for the U.S. in particular, you're going to see geographic boundaries that go down to the county purposes. And that may be sufficient for some of your overview type of analytics, but then when you want to go into more detailed analytics, you'll have to go to the deeper data sets, the more detailed data sets. So, Tom, I'm hoping that was useful.
And we have another question from Larry, and Larry's asking, how can we access the basic NAVTEQ data to begin importing that into our database? And So Larry, that content is actually available from the Oracle Technology Network in a similar area to where the Oracle Business Intelligence downloads are. And if you need, you can send me an email. I can provide that link to you. And as far as accessing the data and getting it loaded into the database, the steps are pretty straightforward. Right now, Capgemini, we've been working on a location intelligence service solution where we're assisting our clients on kind of basically doing what we talked about here today, getting the basic NAVTEQ data spatial set up, working with you to integrate that into Oracle Business Intelligence 11G, working on the proof of concept, and really helping you build towards that spatial analytics location intelligence program. All right. Do we have any more questions coming through, Jessica?
There are no questions over the phone lines.
Okay. All right. Let's turn it back over to Genevieve, and we can wrap up. Steve, I want to thank you again for coming out today and assisting us on the webinar.
My pleasure.
Thanks, Christian. Thanks, Steve. Thanks, everyone, for joining today and the webinar. We'll be sending an email follow-up shortly with a link to the presentation as well as the recording. Before we close, I'd like to highlight that additional training programs can be found through Capgemini's BICG University website. The URL is listed on the contacts page at the end of the presentation. As well, you'll receive an invite shortly with registration details for our next webinar. If you have any remaining questions, please don't hesitate to contact our presenters. Their email addresses can be found within the contacts page of the presentation also. We hope you enjoyed the webinar. We look forward to connecting next time. Thanks so much and have a good day.